Hello everyone, my name is Heidi Fernandes. I'm a UW pharmacy grad from RX2017 that has returned for post-grad studies in pharmacy practice research, specifically travel medicine and immunizations. With both the expansion of pharmacist scope in Ontario to include 13 immunizations in addition to influenza, and the release of the first non-live herpes zoster vaccine, there has been a lot of buzz about shingles. The following presentation will provide a quick refresher on the disease and the vaccines available. By the end of this presentation, viewers will be able to describe the epidemiology, clinical presentation, and complications of herpes zoster. As well, understand the differences between the two vaccines available for herpes zoster, including the new Canadian vaccination recommendations. Herpes zoster, commonly referred to as shingles, occurs when the varicella zoster virus reactivates from its latent state in a posterior dorsal root ganglion. Both chickenpox and herpes zoster are caused by the varicella zoster virus. Chickenpox is the active invasive phase of the virus, whereas shingles represents the reactivation of the latent phase. Due to its travel along nerve pathways to the skin, it is characterized by pain along the affected dermatome, followed by a unilateral vesicular eruption in 2 to 3 days, which is the hallmark diagnostic sign. Shingles occurs most frequently among older adults and immunocompromised persons, such as the elderly population, those with HIV/AIDS, undergoing chemotherapy or radiation, and currently on immunosuppressive medication such as cyclosporine or long-term prednisone use. Age is considered the number one risk factor for development of shingles, as over two-thirds of cases occur in those over 50 years of age. The age-related risk might be attributed to both the waning immunity over time following the initial varicella infection, which is commonly during one's youth, and the loss of cell-mediated immunity to the varicella zoster virus from the natural aging process. Along with the increase in age, the severity of shingles and its complications dramatically increase, with up to 10% of individuals over 65 being admitted to hospital with an episode of shingles. Complications from shingles can be severe, with the most frequent being postherpetic neuralgia, or PHN. Postherpetic neuralgia is characterized by a prolonged neurogenic pain that is often debilitating and can last for more than 90 days from the onset of the rash. Because PHN can be difficult to treat, it often has major adverse impacts on quality of life. Older adults, those who are immunocompromised, and patients with chronic conditions such as diabetes may be at a greater risk of developing postherpetic neuralgia and are also at risk of experiencing a longer-lasting shingles rash than the general population. Although herpes zoster immunization is not a routine or required vaccination, it is highly recommended. Although not everyone who has had chickenpox will develop shingles, almost 1 in 3 Canadians will develop shingles in their lifetime, with its incidence and severity of both herpes zoster and postherpetic neuralgia rapidly increasing after 50 years of age. Every year, there are approximately 130,000 new cases of shingles in Canada. However, the treatment options for herpes zoster rash and postherpetic neuralgia have limited effects. Instead, vaccination can provide a safe and effective alternative in preventing herpes zoster and its complications from occurring. There are two vaccines available to immunize against herpes zoster: Zostavax II, or more commonly referred to as Zostavax, and Shingrix. Zostavax may ring a bell as it has been around much longer than Shingrix, which was just released earlier this year. Zostavax is a live attenuated vaccine commonly referred to in the literature as LZV, standing for live zoster vaccine. It is a subcutaneous injection with a dose of 0.65 ml after being reconstituted. Only one dose is needed for its immunization. The newest injection authorized is Shingrix, which is a non-live recombinant AS01B adjuvated vaccine, commonly referred to as RZV, standing for recombinant zoster vaccine. The adjuvant in RZV induces a high cellular immune response and helps address the natural age-related decline in immunity. It is an IM injection at a dose of 0.5 ml after reconstitution. To achieve full protection, two doses must be administered, with the second dose being 2 to 6 months apart from the first. There are no differences in terms of efficacy of the second dose being administered 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6 months apart. If adherence is an issue, some prescribers may opt for a 0-12-month schedule to improve adherence, as the second dose would be administered at the next annual visit. Here's a table comparing the two vaccinations available for herpes zoster. Shingrix was found to have higher efficacy against herpes zoster and postherpetic neuralgia across all age groups studied in comparison to Zostavax. Additionally, the protection with Shingrix lasts for at least 4 years as opposed to 3 years with Zostavax. Zostavax's protection was also found to wane at a much higher rate after 1 year post-immunization, whereas protection wanes much slower with Shingrix. Shingrix also had a similar immune response across all age groups, which was demonstrated up to 9 years post-immunization. However, Zostavax's immune response was best for those between ages of 50 and 59, demonstrated up to 3 years post-immunization, but its immunogenicity decreases with age. Both vaccines are safe in immunocompetent patients, with injection site reactions being the most common side effect. Due to the adjuvant in Shingrix, which induces a high immune response, it is more reactogenic than Zostavax, leading to more reactions that were severe enough to prevent normal activities. However, these reactions are transient, lasting less than 3 days. Fatigue and myalgia are common in both vaccinations, but have a higher incidence with Shingrix along with headaches. Both vaccines cannot be used in patients with known hypersensitivities to the vaccine or any of its components. Shingrix has no known allergens, but Zostavax has allergens including neomycin and porcine gelatin. Additionally, Zostavax is contraindicated in immunodeficient and pregnant individuals and cautioned in breastfeeding, whereas those patient characteristics are only precautioned in Shingrix, not contraindicated. Now that you have the basics of each vaccine, we will discuss the updated recommendations that were released by the National Advisory Committee on Immunization earlier this summer. Immunization with a two-dose series of Shingrix is recommended for the prevention of herpes zoster and postherpetic neuralgia in adults 50 years of age and older without contraindications, including those with or without a history of varicella. Regardless of whether the person has a history of varicella infection, Shingrix should be administered. Nearly all Canadians eligible for herpes zoster immunization will have had a prior varicella exposure, even if a diagnosis of varicella cannot be recalled. There is no known safety risk associated with immunization of healthy individuals who are susceptible to varicella zoster virus in the appropriate age groups. Immunization with a two-dose series of Shingrix should be held at least 1 year after an adult age 50 years and older has been previously immunized with Zostavax. Due to Shingrix efficacy, re-immunization is encouraged as long as this 1 year interval can be kept. This differs from the American recommendations on the Advisory Committee of Immunization Practices, ACIP, which recommends Shingrix be given at least 2 months after Zostavax administration, which is based on expert opinion. Those who have had a previous episode of shingles can also be immunized with Shingrix at least 1 year after their shingles episode. If a patient is currently experiencing shingles, they cannot be immunized. If Shingrix is contraindicated, unavailable, or inaccessible, Zostavax may be considered for immunocompetent individuals 50 years of age and older without contraindications. Individuals who are immunocompromised, either due to a medical condition or immunosuppressive agents, have an increased risk of developing shingles. They are also more likely to experience recurrence, atypical and/or severe disease, and complications. Vaccination with Shingrix should be considered on an individual case-by-case basis after assessing the benefits versus risks. This is another difference between the Canadian and American recommendations. As immunocompromised patients that were on moderate or high doses of immunosuppressive therapy were excluded from the clinical trials, ACIP has not made recommendations for this population. They have, however, recommended that patients on low-dose immunosuppressive therapy, for example, less than 20 milligrams of prednisone per day, receive Shingrix, which can be used in your risk stratification of these patients. If a patient is starting an immunosuppressive treatment that may lead to immunodeficiency, for example, chemotherapy, it is recommended that the vaccine be administered at least 14 days before treatment begins. Although more data needs to be obtained, individuals with autoimmune disease that are not being treated with immunosuppressive drugs are not considered significantly immunocompromised. These individuals 50 years and older without contraindications should receive Shingrix. If an individual is in close contact to a person with shingles and have not previously had chickenpox or varicella immunization, neither of these vaccines should be administered for post-exposure prophylaxis. Persons with herpes zoster are considered infectious, passing on the varicella zoster virus until all their lesions are crusted over. Close contact to a person with herpes zoster includes touching the rash, exposed lesion, or vesicle fluid, contact with an individual who has disseminated herpes zoster, contact with articles freshly soiled by discharges from the vesicles, contact with articles freshly soiled by mucous membrane secretions of an infected person with disseminated herpes zoster, and exposure to an immunosuppressed person with localized herpes zoster anywhere on the body, as viral shedding in these individuals may be greater. Depending on the patient's immunization history, post-exposure prophylaxis may be warranted with the varicella vaccination. More information can be found in the Canadian Immunization Guide. To summarize, herpes zoster is a reactivation of the varicella zoster virus, which primarily manifests as chickenpox. It is characterized by a vesicular rash with associated neuropathic pain. Its most frequent complication is postherpetic neuralgia, which can be significantly debilitating. There are two vaccines available to immunize against herpes zoster, Shingrix and Zostavax. Due to its efficacy and immunogenicity, Shingrix is considered first line in individuals aged 50 years or older without contraindications, including those without a history of varicella infection, those that have had Zostavax immunization, those that have had a previous shingles episode, and immunocompromised individuals on a case-by-case basis. Thank you for listening to my presentation on herpes zoster. If you have any questions, please feel free to email me at this address.